Good morning, everyone. This is Ramesh Nogain, your presenter. First thing first, please confirm on the chat window that you can hear me well and you can see my screen, which is currently flashing introduction to RPA, Robotic Process Automation. Thank you, Sachin, Deepak, Chitindra, Subhash, Himani. Very well, thank you so much. Let's get started. So welcome to the webinar on Robotic Process Automation from DevLabs Alliance. Over the next 1 hour, we will be talking about Robotic Process Automation, what it is, where it can be applied, what benefits we can expect. So let's get started. The agenda for next 1 hour would be to have a quick introduction, talk about robotic process automation, see a few demos in action, and towards the end, we will be building a bot. Throughout the session, we will have a Q&A. Please feel free to post your question on the chat window, and I will take your question at the appropriate time as early as possible. So with that, let's get started. Quick introduction about myself. I'm a certified RPA trainer with more than 20 years of IT experience. To date, I have delivered more than 75 batches in RPA, trained more than 2,000 professionals. I've delivered trainings to corporates, e-learning platform-based batches, as well as to universities. Some of the names that you can see are Deloitte, KPMG, Ernst & Young, PwC, Accenture, Infosys, IBM, Oracle, and many more. There are companies who are not in IT, they are into some other businesses like chemicals. I also deliver trainings to e-learning platform-based batches and to universities. In the past, I have worked with companies such as NewGen Software Technologies, Headstrong Genpact, SDG, and NIC. The last work that I have delivered was on BPM, Business Process Management, which is essentially a business process automation technology, where you do a little bit of coding, software coding, to build your automations. RP also does the same thing at the end of the day, but here we are basically going to do hardly any coding. Also, I've used document management system, DMS, in delivering process automation, which are document intensive. Some of the certificates that I hold in RPA, the customer feedback from my clients, I've written a book also on RPA. It's titled as Robotic Process Automation for Developers, published by PactHub, available on Udemy. Participated in a hackathon a few months back in Delhi and we won the second position. With that, I would like to know a little bit about yourself. Over the next 20 seconds, if you can post on the chat window, only two things: your current role, title, and total years of experience. Only two items I would expect from your side. If you can please post on the chat window, just post the role that you're playing right now in your workplace and the total years of experience you have. Thank you, Sachin, Java developer, 10 years. QA manager, 14 years. RP architect with 8 years, 12 years in automation, very nice. Java developer with 7 years. Test engineer, SQL database, 5 years. Program management, 9 years. Automation developer, 12 years. Development and Automation, 14 years. SDET, 6 years. Very well. Thank you for sharing your work profile role and the total years of experience. It will help me a lot. So now I know that many of the participants are from the automation world, from the software development world, from the QA and QA automation world. With that, let's proceed and get started with our session. So let's have introduction to robotic process automation, what exactly it is, and what we can really achieve from this technology. As you must be hearing that it is the one of the hottest technology around. In fact, so much so that it is probably the number one, number two technology, which is being adopted by businesses for implementing process automations in their work domain. Especially for the people who are very new to RPA, we'll talk about a quick introduction to RPA, and then we'll be having a few demos. So let's talk about robotic process automation. And as I mentioned, feel free to post your question on the chat window, and I'll take your questions at the appropriate time. So what is robotic process automation? Three words: robotic, process, automation. Let's dissect each and every word, and that will give you a very good understanding, especially for the people who are very, very new to RPA. So what is a process? Process is a series of predetermined, predefined, ordered steps that you must execute every time. No matter who does it, who executes it, it must be executed every time the same way. So it's a series of predefined, predetermined, ordered steps, series of steps. I'll use manufacturing as an analogy. We are not going to talk about the manufacturing or the physical robots. We'll be talking about software robots. RPA is all about software robots. But let's draw an analogy that what we have achieved in the manufacturing world, now we are achieving the same thing in the software world for the business processes, for the IT processes. Now in a manufacturing world, let's say we want to manufacture a component, a part, we surely would be having a process to achieve it. What about business domain? Yes, we do have processes in our business domain. How you do it, that is not important, but you have a process that you must execute every time the same way to achieve the desired output and hence the desired outcome. Then what is automation? Automation means that you achieve something with little or no human interaction, human assistance, human intervention, something that you achieve without or with little human intervention. We manufacture, we discovered that there is a wheel, then we manufactured a bicycle. Bicycle helped us to move from point A to point B with little intervention. Of course, you have to pedal and you have to steer. Then we went to the next level of automation, which is motorcycle, then motor car. In motor car, you hardly do anything except steering and pressing your accelerator or brakes, isn't it? And now we are going to the next level of automation, which is autonomous cars. So just to set the context in terms of automation. Now, do we have automation in manufacturing? Coming back to the manufacturing and the business process analogy. Yes, the same process that we had in manufacturing, we have automated them with the help of what? Machines. We have machines powered by electricity, and we are able to manufacture those components, those parts, those items in a mass level, at a mass level. But what about the business processes? We have business processes which we have automated with the help of what? Software. We have software, especially over the last 40, 50 years, we have automated our business processes with the help of software, isn't it? Today we have computers, we have devices, monitor, keyboard, mouse, and then we work on the softwares, be it a legacy software like mainframe or, you know, new age softwares, Salesforce, ServiceNow, SAP ERP, Oracle ERP, productivity tools like Excel, PDF, mail, desktop application, web application, local application, remote application, software. The key point is that we have automated our business processes with the help of software. Something what we achieved in manufacturing with machines, we have achieved with the help of software over the last 40, 50 years. Great. That is automation. Then what is this robotic? What is the meaning of robotic? Something that we achieve, something that we replicate, the way we do as human beings. So mimicking human actions, replicating human actions is robotic. Have we achieved the next level of automation through robotic in manufacturing? Yes. You can see that despite we have automated many components, many parts of, say, for example, car manufacturing, we still have people working on this assembly line to come up with the final product. People are involved. People are doing the last mile automation in that sense, or last mile work. And that last mile automation is achieved in manufacturing through robotics. In new age plants, you will hardly see the scene that you see on the upper image. You will see more and more of the robotics in manufacturing world. But that is just an analogy that I wanted to have from the business process automation perspective. Think about it. We have created software over the last 40, 50 years, especially over the last 30 years. But these softwares, in many of the cases, are consumed by human beings. Human beings are using these softwares to execute business processes. So do we have something similar to the robotics in manufacturing, the same thing that do we have anything on the business process automation? Answer is yes now. And that is RPA, robotic process automation. Mimicking human actions on business software applications is what RPA essentially does. So let's have a few basic demos and then we'll come back to our presentation and talk more about it. So what I will do, I will use a software called UiPath. I'll start the software UiPath. It is number one product at the moment in the industry as far as RPA products are concerned. And using this UiPath software, we'll run a few demos so that you have understanding about how a RPA robot functions. We'll start with a very, very basic, extremely basic automation. As simple as, you know, just opening a notepad and writing something to it. Especially for the people who are very new, let me just do it manually. So say I want to work on, notepad. So I first of all will open notepad. I would like to write something into it. And then I want to basically save it. So what I essentially have done is I have basically performed two actions so far as a human being. I performed a click action to open notepad, and then I performed the typing action to type some text in the notepad. The third action that I'm performing is a click action using mouse to save the file. So click on file, click on save, And then I'm performing the next action, which is action number 5th now. And I'm writing some file name. So my new file.txt. And the next action I'm doing is click action on save to save the file. And then finally clicking on this cross close icon to close the file. So what I've done essentially that I basically have performed some 6-7 actions to get the work done. Of course, this is a very simple automation, but just to explain what robotic is all about, is mimicking human actions. Now, what I just did is same is available. I have same automated in a UiPath automation script. UiPath allows one to build automation by drag and drop of activities. We'll talk about it. Essentially, you are basically building a graphical model to build your automation. So it's a process map, it's a process representation in the graphical way. And if I execute this automation, I'll just click on this debug file and click on run file, it will start a robot. So robot will start, that UI icon at the bottom taskbar that you can see with white background is the robot. And it will perform those actions, what I showed you as a human worker. Right now, a digital worker, a software robot is doing the job, performing the same actions that I did as a human being. And job done. It'll close down. A robot has done it, right? Okay, great. Pretty simple, hello world kind of a automation. Let's move forward and see at least a couple of more automations. I'll go into more a detailed one. Let's say that I have a data set to be processed, and the data set is in the form of Excel file, which is coming through an email attachment. And that email attachment has data in it. Let me show you an example. This is my data set for depositing into a bank application. So there is account number, amount of data to be submitted, and the mode of transaction is a deposit entry into the business application. And the business application is a bank corporate application. From demo perspective, a simple application is there, which I'm starting as RCN Bank. It requires login credentials to be provided. So I'm providing that and entering into the application. Pretty straightforward stuff. You can very well replace the RCN Bank from your business application, web or desktop. And then of course, I will be entering the data. If I have to do it manually, obviously, I have to copy paste data from Excel file to my bank application. So whatever that number comes out to be. Okay, whatever. And then the amount of deposit, the mode of transaction, optional notes, and then I'll click on submit. So pretty straightforward, right? You're interacting with the application in a human worker way. And the, whatever the transaction ID comes out to be, I will be entering that over here. I'll record it, whatever that number is, and declare it as successful. Now, obviously, as a human being, it is a repeatable work and perhaps boring work for human worker. And such kind of things you will see a lot in your work area. Not each and every process, but many processes, especially around, you know, human intensive processes where the data is very well defined. You can find these scenarios a lot in your workplaces. So how can I get this work done by a robot? So let me close down everything and run it through my automation. So what you see on your screen right now is the process model for the work that I just showed you. And there's a lot of details inside individual steps. So if I just open, say, Excel automation piece. So all the steps, how an Excel file data will be processed, is all detailed out here. And that is my automation. A software robot will execute this automation in real world. All right, let's start. I'm starting the automation. You can see the software robot has started. So there are two pieces we are talking about right now. The software for building automation, and that is UiPath Studio, where you saw that graphical model. And the second piece is the software robot, the robot that UI icon that you see at the bottom of my screen in the taskbar is the software robot. This software robot is executing the process model that you saw in the graphical mode. Great, my software robot is working, but it's not doing anything. It is actually checking my email box and waiting for that data to arrive. All right, so let me send a sample email to myself because my email box is being checked by this robot. So I quickly will send out an email to myself. And now this email can come anytime. So I'll simply write a very basic message. Please process the deposit transactions in the corporate application. Some basic, not required, but just to put a message. And I'll attach the bank data sheet where my deposit details are. I'll send it across. It might take a minute or two before this email comes back in my email box. And once it comes back to my email box, my robot will start into, you know, start performing the actions. So let's wait for a minute or so, and you will see that the robot will start processing it. In the meantime, I'll keep on checking my mobile device for the email. I'll share once I have the email. Probably will have to wait for a minute or so. So what essentially will happen is that the robot is continuously checking my email box. And once it finds an email, a new email with the predefined criteria. So in this case, I'm checking on the subject and the attachment. Once a matching email arrives, it will download the attachment of that email, save it into some area, and will start the process. The process is to open the business application, RCN Bank. It will log in into the RCN Bank by using the credentials. And the important part is the credentials are not part of the automation script. It is external to the automation script, that graphical model that you saw. It is stored in my credential vault. So robot on the fly will fetch the credentials to log in. It will successfully log in into the business application. And after that, it will open the Excel file and process the data row by row, transaction by transaction. It will perform all those transactions and will record the transaction outcome, which is the transaction ID and whether it is successful or not, back into the Excel file. Now, if you have noticed, there are some transactions within the Excel file which has which have invalid data, some transaction values, especially the, so email has just arrived. All right, so it has started, as you can see, it has logged in into the business application, and now it is processing the data transaction by transaction. If you notice 50,000, 100,000, 200,000, there is a additional space. That means it's an invalid number. So business data is not correct. So the robot is doing the job and performing the operations and recording it back into the Excel file very well. Now what I will do, I'll try to disturb the robot. Let me crash the application. I will crash the application. I'm picking up the mouse right now. I'm doing it and I'll crash it. Let's see whether the robot can recover. Yes, robot has realized that the application is not available. Application is down, application is not responding, and it has restarted the application, something that you and I would do as a human worker if we face the same problem. Let me crash it one more time. So you can see that there are two failed transactions so far because of invalid business data. And now again, the two transactions failed because application was not available at that time. Let me crash one more final time. And again, the robot will recover from the error situation. So the point is this, that you can very well build a process automation, taking care of all the scenarios that typically we would face in real world scenario. Right now, it is processing it, and what actually happened at the time I just closed it, at it took some additional time. So you can see that two transactions have failed because of the application was not available. The second transition started just the time when I basically closed it. Now, smartly, the robot will process those transactions which have failed earlier because of applications reasons. So you can see that all the transactions, because at the time the application was not available, but now the application is very much available, and surely the robot can process those transactions successfully and has done the job. Excellent. My robot is still working, right? And you can see that it is waiting for the next data set to arrive to process the next data. But right now I'll just stop my automation and move on to the next one. Great. So let me start another one, which will be using some additional capabilities, more comprehensive in that sense. And it is basically going to run the automation in a dual mode, attended mode as well as unattended. So this automation is about downloading your 26AS, the TDS document from India Income Tax web portal, Traces. And in this one, it will be processing a set of data which I have recorded in my input file. So if I quickly show you my input file. So I have a set of records, and it's a password protected. So my robot will be able to unlock or open the Excel file, which is password protected, just the way we are doing it. Of course, it will do it internally. And the credentials are stored in a secure place in my credential vault. So I have some sample set of PAN numbers and the folder output where I should be storing my output files. Assessment years for which it has to download the 26AS. And then I do have another field which is saying that, okay, whether you would like to download it or not. So only three PAN numbers I'm saying yes, download, rest I'm ignoring. Okay, so first, fourth, and sixth, I'm saying yes, rest should not be downloaded by the robot. Another thing, the entire automation will be working under a configuration. And if I show you, because in this automation, I have some data, I have some pieces, which is going to be processed through a non-structured data perspective. RP is very good with structured data. But when it comes to the non-structured data, especially content such as which are freestyle, content such as which are in the image form, the data conversion from image text to a digital text might not be 100% accurate in all the scenarios. So a lot depends on the underlying quality. So the question is that how we can take care of these situations and apply technology such as OCR, and even beyond that, we can apply AI technologies to even further improve our chances of success. Still, there can be exceptions. Still, there can be situations where it may not work, but at least you are increasing your chances of successfully processing your data. So here, what we have is basically that OCR way. Let me change it to say two times, means robot will try two times before it gives the control to the human worker. So this automation will take care of, you know, if a robot can work on its own independently throughout, great. But if it fails, then what it will do, it will send the control to a human worker, and human worker will be able to help the robot for the piece which robot is not able to do. So OCR way, two attempts, and human way is two attempts. And this will be taken, this will come into consideration only if the robot fails. All right, let me come out of it and go back to my automation and start it. Let's see. All right, so I've started my automation. My software robot has started. Going to the clean desktop, that's a part of the automation. Opening the income tax website, clearing the splash screen and going to the login page. The tooltips that you can see is a part of the automation just from the demo perspective. So here we go. It will first try the first PAN number. The first attempt is in progress right now. It is entering the PAN number. It is entering the password. And now it is converting this image, that capture you see, right? It is failed. As you can see, it is failed. That's the wrong conversion. So it will fail. And as program, as automated, it will try again. Let's see. So second attempt is in progress right now by the robot. Of course, I can go, I need not be in front of my computer when the robot is working. But in case, if it fails and can't succeed, so this again has failed. As you can see, it is not B, it is 9 at the last. So all the two attempts have been exhausted. Now the robot will go into the human way because that's the configuration I had in my this automation, right? So it will write the PAN number, great, write the password, and now it will go to the human way. Now you can see a pop-up has come. Now I'm picking my mouse and cursor, and then I'm basically helping the robot. So W3Y7HB, well, it can be B, it could be 3, looks like it is 3. So I'm giving it to the robot, and now the robot will pick up. So robot will continue beyond that. Now, what additional thing we have done in this automation? Now, successfully logged in, great. It will click on my account now, and rest of the process will continue. It will go to the Tracy's website, will perform the form filling, which is for assessment year and the how you want to see it, clicking on the export as PDF, waiting for the download to start. Once the download starts, it will click on save, save as, and the normal stuff that you and I would do to save the 26 years. So 26 years has been saved, great job. Now it will process the next PAN number, and likewise, PAN number 2 and PAN number 3, we already have declared as, you know, we don't want to download it. So PAN number 4 from the total 6 PAN numbers will be processed now. Every PAN number is different, every credentials are different, so it has to re-log in. Again, it is performing the same operations. Let's see whether the OCR succeeds this time. So OCR stands for optical character recognition. And in fact, beyond this, we can very well apply some machine learning. So right now it is a plain vanilla. So this time it is successfully has converted. So bot doesn't need any help. Is proceeding further and doing the things. Now coming to that image-based text, I can very well have a machine learning algorithm behind the scene, which is actually learning from my, so like the human being is helping, isn't it? In certain scenarios, not all the scenarios, certain scenarios. And from there, it can very well build its own learning capabilities and can build that, you know, intelligence of improving the chances of converting that image-based text to a normal text. But right now the machine learning piece is not involved. It is just the OCR, the best ability of the OCR engine, which is in play right now. All right, the third and final PAN number in action, performing the data entry for the PAN number, for the password of that PAN, applying the OCR, doesn't look right to me. It is 6, not 5. So it will fail this time. It will try the second attempt because that's the way it has been configured. And another thing is that you may ask that, okay, what if the human worker is not around? Not a problem. The way it has been designed that, if the robot needs human interaction and the human worker is not there for, say, next 90 seconds or so, then it will declare that transaction or that download has failed and move on to the next one. That would be the appropriate thing, isn't it? So that there's no bottleneck for the robot. Okay, so it has exhausted all the two attempts from the normal standard way. Now it is performing the human way. So entering the data and seeking help from human worker, right? So I'll just, as a human worker, I'm just helping. All right, done deal. And it will process the data. So you just saw that you can very well have a business process which is very complicated, not just one or two applications you can automate. You can automate as number of, any number of applications in your business process. And your business process might have some local applications, some remote applications. So a robot can very well connect over Citrix, over VMware, remote desktop connection, absolutely no problem, right? So technologies are there, the capabilities are there in RPA to automate applications which are running in remote computers as well. So wanted to show you these couple of demos, and let me come back to my presentation and talk about a few more pieces before we go into building a simple automation. So there was a question from Subhash, do we have demo on intelligent automation also? So intelligent automation directly, it is not there, but I just have explained from the usage point of view. Yes, we can very well have like from document understanding, from image understanding, and building, you know, some AI components, leveraging AI components behind the scene. Of course, you can build our own AI algorithms and leverage it within our RP automation. So in short, what is RPA? RPA is mimicking human actions. Mimicking human actions. Replicating human actions. Today we work like this. We work outside of a computer and we interact with the applications, business applications through devices. The three devices that we use, monitor, keyboard, and mouse. And now we are in a position to replicate those actions that typically we perform using RPA. So with RPA, we can very well automate those pieces which are typically very mundane, repeatable, rule-based, involving structured data in principle. Yes, we can deal with unstructured data too. But in principle, RPA will be a very state-to-use technology, especially when you have data in the structured format. Can we apply RPA in a distributed environment? Yes, very much. I can very well have our business process applications running in a distributed environment and can very well perform those actions. Just like you would do it in your distributed environment, same would be the case for a software robot. The software robot might be getting data from maybe FTP server, from email attachment, from doing a telnet to some other remote application machines, coming back, opening SAP ERP, for example, logging in into using the credentials which are stored in credential vault or at enterprise identity and access management software, putting the data, maybe it has to do perform certain transactions into as part of the same process into a corporate server which doesn't allow access outside. So you have to log in through your credentials over the Citrix or a secured network and then perform certain actions on a different application which is running in a different server somewhere in the world. So robot will connect just like you and I would connect using Citrix or VMware or any VM software or the connectivity software that we use and perform the actions. So short answer, yes, we can very well perform those actions in a distributed environment. Can two robots work on a single Excel file? And also two team members are working on the same shared file? Yes. If the underlying technology, so here's the thumb rule. If you can do it as human workers, as human workforce, very, very, very likely you can do it with software robots. So can a software robot work on a single Excel file? Yes, it can. Can a multiple, you know, robots work on the same file? Yes. Multiple processes work on the same file? Yes. Not a problem at all, right? So we do have that technology within the RPA wherein the multiple processes can work on the single Excel file at the same time. Can I run multiple processes in the same computer, same robot, the multiple processes are running on the same computer? Answer is yes, right? So we can very well have our background processes which are working, in multiple instances or multiple processes are getting executed. Can a human worker work while a robot is also working on the same computer? Yes. Can I have multiple background processes running at the same time when a human worker is also working? Yes. So many combinations are very much possible. So now that the human worker is working as a outside of the computer, well, we have a software robot working inside the computer, isn't it? That is the case that we have with robotics now. So what are the processes that would be a good candidate for RPA? By now you would be having a good understanding about many of these characteristics, many of these attributes that you should have in your process for RPA candidature. So any process which is human intensive, chances are that is a very good candidate for RPA. Plus, if that process, human intensive process, is repeatable, is rule-based, is workflow-driven. Workflow-driven means that it is very well defined what steps to perform one after another. The chances of that applying RPA is even higher. Interacting at graphical user level, graphical user interface, UI level, yes. Doesn't mean that RPA cannot work on background processes or background execution. It can. It need not have just the graphical user interface. But the fact is that most of the human workers, virtually all, in fact, the operations people, business users, end users, how do we interact with our business applications? Through graphical user interface. Whether it's ERPs of the world, customer relationship management or software, trading platform, or any software for that matter, just imagine we interact with some interface, isn't it? But RPA is very much capable of working purely at the back end. No user interface involved, yes, very much possible. When your data involved is structured in nature, yes, the chances get even better from the RPA success point of view. It gets even more meaningful from the benefits perspective when you have large and continuous volume of data. The getting benefits from out RPA is even better. RPA is called as non-invasive technology. Non-invasive technology. Why? Because in RPA, we do not modify underlying process. Also, in RPA, we do not modify underlying technology, or we make modification in the software. Make sense? No process change, no technology change, no software modification. All the processes that you are automating will remain same. All your business applications will remain same, no change. All we are doing is mimicking human actions, the way human workers are working on these business applications. Now, instead of human workers, the digital workers will start working on these applications. From that perspective, it is called non-invasive. And because of this reason, one of the reasons, it has become a very easy buy from CXOs. Because there's no modification we are doing in the underlying landscape, be it from process side or software side. So what are the benefits you can expect? Obviously, one question Sokshia has asked, I hope I pronounced the name correctly. How can we ensure accuracy, consistency, and sometimes flexibility from digital workforce? Well, the advantage of RP automations are, you can see that one straight away benefit that you can achieve from RPA is that we will be saving hours that we spend as human workers. As human workers, we spend some part of our work, daily routine or, you know, whatever, weekly, we spend time on things which are very repetitive, boring, mundane. We can very well automate that now with RPA technology. What will be the benefit? The benefit would be that we'll be saving hours, which we can spend on some higher valued things in our workplace, for our business, for our customers, and for ourselves as well. Human workforce is good at creativity, troubleshooting, team building, organization, communication, ideation. That is what we should be doing more and more, rather than spending time on boring, mundane work. We can offload that work to human worker, to digital workers. Now, from that perspective, the four pillars of any decision: will I be able to have the work done at a lower cost with the digital workers? Yes. What about the efficiency? Will I be having higher efficiency? Because a software robot can do the same work much faster. So I'm having that benefit. Can my software robot work more than a human worker? Absolutely, yes. Theoretically speaking, a software robot can work 24/7, 365. So it can produce more and faster. And because software robots will perform as instructed, it won't commit mistakes like us. I tend to commit mistakes when I'm bored, I'm tired, I'm sick, my attention is somewhere else. I'm copying data from one transaction and pasting it for some other, you know, entry in my corporate bank. That will be disastrous, isn't it? So we do commit those mistakes, but software robot will not do it. So from accuracy point of view, software robots will perform much better than us. Consistency, yes, very much. It's the same thing. It will be consistent all through. And because software robots can work anytime, it's very flexible in that sense. You can very well say, okay, robot, you work only in the night time when the computers are free and we will be expecting data from our remote office, which is working in different time zone altogether, and the data comes during the night time. Please work on that the moment you get the data. Just like you saw that earlier demo where the robot started working on that Excel data sheet whenever it arrived. And if it arrives in the midnight, sure, my robot will be flexible enough to work on it. So we have all the controls working with the robots. And of course, it will help in increased satisfaction all through with businesses, because businesses are able to do it at lower cost, with higher accuracy, with higher efficiency, and they are able to do it more. You know, obviously, the customers will be delighted because they are getting the same, you know, work done, their same the responses what they were getting earlier, with the higher accuracy and much faster way. The service level agreements will be better. All good, good, good. But what about employees? In employees also, we will be able to get it much better in terms of the, you know, how we can take care of our repetitive, boring work by offloading it to robots, by automating it through RPA. It is RPA is a empowering technology, employee empowering technology, wherein it can be helpful to at individual level as well as from the business side, the customer side. Also, RPA is a very good technology from the agility point of view. RPA projects are typically short duration projects in terms of weeks. So we talk about, like, you know, it's an 8 week, 12, you know, 16 weeks, 20 weeks kind of project. Unlike the software development projects where we talk in terms of quarters or months. So what essentially is happening with RPA is that today we work like this, human workforce, and now it is already happening. We have digital workers. Digital workers work inside computers. It's just a representation that you see in the physical robots, form, but not really. They are not physical. They are digital in nature. So what essentially is happening is it's a great opportunity, you know, from the career point of view also, that we, as per the McKinsey, as much as 1/5 of the work that we do globally will be automated. Just think about it. Just imagine. If I translate it, every 5th worker in next 10 years time frame will be digital in nature. Very much possible. It's already happening. It's already started. And you'll see a gigantic jump every 2-3 years time frame. Couple of questions. What is the future of landscape for RPA? And what kind of roles are available in process industry? Do we need good coding skills? Yeah, we'll be covering that. So that's coming up. So first of all, the future landscape of RPA. So RPA is actually going from the core RPA to intelligent RPA. And that's the next couple of slides. So there are two types of robots essentially, attended robots and unattended robots. Attended robots are those which are basically, robots will work in coordination with human worker. The demo that you saw earlier, 26 years, an unattended robot will work, which are independent right from start to end on its own. But when you include AI, artificial intelligence technology with RPA, essentially we will be making our robots intelligent robots. So if RPA is mimicking human actions, AI is mimicking human intelligence. And with the help of AI and analytics, our robots will be intelligent. So the future landscape is, so the RPA ecosystem is increasing a lot. In the industry today, we surely need RPA developers. As you saw that, as much as, one fifth of the work, 20% of the work globally can be automated. That's the, research by McKinsey. When we include AI with our RPA, we will be able to solve those problems in an automated manner, which typically requires the human intelligence. But with the AI intelligence, we will be able to build those automations. It is basically called as IPA, Intelligent Process Automation in the industry. So let me address some of the questions before we move forward. So what are the roles that are available in the industry today? So from the work perspective, we need RPA developers. We need RPA business analysts who are going to work with customers to capture requirements, analyze requirements, and work with the delivery development team to build automations, becoming a conduit or bridge between the customer, business, and the development team. So developers, business analyst, we need people who are basically good at the implementation side. We understand infrastructure, we understand the landscape in terms of implementation, so implementation engineers from RPA. Then we need operations, people who are going to work with the software robots in production. In UiPath, and in fact many other softwares, we do have the cloud-based server. The third component in RPA landscape or RPA software stack is the server side. So far, we have talked about two components. One is the RPA studio, where you develop the automation. And second is the RPA robot, which executes the automation. The third component is the server component. I can very well provision my digital workers, my digital robots in a cloud setup. Now this cloud could be a private cloud, could be your in-premise setup, absolutely no problem. Or you can very well deploy it onto a cloud on AWS or Azure or GCP, Google Cloud Platform, perfectly fine. The point is that I can manage my digital workers from a central web or mobile app interface, and I can manage my robots globally. There could be 100 robots working in Japan office, 200 working in your California office, 100 working in your London office, 500 working in your India office, blah, blah, blah. You will be able to manage them from a central cloud environment, right? So yes, we can very well do it. Now, one common question comes that what kind of skill set I need to become a RPA developer or a professional who is into RPA automation? The great part about RPA is that it doesn't require a deep understanding, deep knowledge, deep experience in programming. So what it basically does is you can very well build automation with very elementary knowledge. And if you don't have elementary knowledge about programming, that is also fine because you can pick up that skill. You can pick up that knowledge as you start working on RPA. Basic concepts such as data types, variables, control flows like loops, exception handling, arrays. These are the some basic tenets of programming that you would be requiring. If you don't have it, still not a problem. You can build it, but if you have it, nothing like it. But you don't definitely don't need a deep dive understanding and knowledge about programming. Basic elementary knowledge is good enough to become a RPA professional. Now, in addition to the roles like developer role, the business analyst role, the implementation engineer role, the production operations role, there can be other roles as well, like infrastructure specialist, a role which is project manager or program manager from RPA perspective. So there can be some specialized roles as well. All right. So that was the prerequisite. So one other question, what is required for successful automation with respect to RPA skills? And okay, so most of these questions I've covered. So let's continue with my slides. A couple of more slides before we go into the, have a quick live demo. So what processes are suitable for RPA? The great thing about RPA is that RPA is business domain agnostic and it is technology domain agnostic. Means it's a horizontal technology, can be applied anywhere. Some of the popular processes popular, but can be applied anywhere as long as you have those characteristics. So process from order processing, invoice processing, claim processing, order to pay, procure to pay, order to cash, record to report, reconciliation, onboarding, deboarding, payroll processing in HR, can be applied in IT service management as well. RPA is being used in QA automation as well, by the way. QA automation, right? So people who are coming from QA automation will see RPA very similar to that, field. Yes, but it is much, much, much more than a typical QA automation. Here we are talking about the process automation. So who are the leaders? What kind of products are available in the industry today from RPA automation? The top three leaders in RPA world are UiPath at number one, Automation Anywhere, and Blue Prism. These are the top three. But in industry, there are more than 30 products that you can see. Some of the worthy names as per Forrester Wave, top 15 products, Edgeverb, Softomotive, WorkFusion, NICE, Cofex, IntelliBot, Cryon, Pega RPA, ServiceTrace, Another Monday, Antworks, and Contextor. Some of these big companies like SAP has acquired Contextor, OpenSpan RPA was acquired by Pega, Blue Prism acquired Thoughtonomy. So many merger and acquisitions are happening. But if I just stick with the top leaders in the market today, UiPath, Automation Anywhere, and Blue Prism are leading the pack. The market is growing very fast. In the next 4 years, it is expected to be a 13 billion plus market. Huge, huge market. Now think about it. From the market point of view, and you can do your own research on Monster and Gnocchi and other places, just search for RPA jobs, it's humongous. It's growing, there's a lot of need requirement in RPA. Just think about it in the next 3 to 4 years, where we are today, that itself is great, but if we will become three times, we're expected to become three times of what we are today. Just imagine. So the skills required in the market is big. So with that, let me come to the towards the end of my session, and we'll build a quick bot, especially for people who are very new. So what I'll do, I'll start UiPath Studio, which is open right now, and we'll create a new process. And I'll simply say DLA, and I'll just, that's the name of my project I'm giving. So very simple automation, super simple automation I'll do in the next 5 minutes or so. And my requirement is this, that I would like to open a, current stock exchange, the top leaders. So if I go to NSC India website and want you to extract the data, which is the top leaders right now in the market. So top leaders are here. I would like to click on this and this data, which is visible to us, I would like to extract it and save it into an Excel file. Okay. That's my goal. All right. Let's see how we can do it. Pretty easy. RPA automation is all drag and drop. Most of the time you'll be performing those actions. So let me quickly go there and build an automation. So this is my main area for my automation. I'll go to the activities tab and look for open browser activity. Everything is called as activity. All the actions are very well built for us, and all we have to do is drag and drop and build the automation. My URL is this. So I'll copy this and will place my URL. So what it does, it basically is saying that open a browser and go to this URL. As simple as that. Great. After that, what I need to do is I need to perform a click on this view all, isn't it? Mimicking human actions, mimicking. So I'll search for click action. There's one click action under mouse. I'll drag and drop inside my do block and click on this indicate element inside browser. This way we are telling our automation that, okay, this is the action that robot has to perform to go to the next point. So moment I click on it, you can see that I'm in the selection mode. And what is happening, this is a real RPA in action. My RPA software, which is UiPath right now, is able to understand individual UI element identifiers. It knows that, yes, this is the view all. You can see there are multiple view alls on the screen, but this has a unique ID behind the scene. And this being a web application is HTML at the back end. More accurately, it is DOM, document object model, which is in action. So it can pick up the details which is required by the robot at runtime to uniquely identify this element, UI element, and perform that click action on it. I'm going to pick it up. Done. I'm back in my automation. So now my robot would have this detail. My automation has this detail and robot will use it to perform click on that particular view all. Now I want to extract the data. Right, that's my next step. Now, instead of performing drag and drop, there are some wizards available in UiPath. One wizard is called data scraping. I'll be performing that data scraping. So let me click on this wizard and it starts a wizard and it will guide you what you need to do. So it says, open the browser and go to the page where you have the what you want to extract. So first of all, I'll go inside and keep my that page ready. So my data table is ready. It says click on next and select any cell. I'm selecting any cell. And now the wizard smartly has discovered that the data that I'm trying to extract is actually belongs to a table and is offering me, would you like to extract the data from the whole table? If I say no, then only that field will be extracted. That data will be extracted, that only one value. But because I'm interested in the whole table, I happily will say yes. Done. The previous close also is there. This is just a preview data, sample data. Preview close is also there, but it's gone below the cell. I'll simply say yes, finish it. By the way, you can replace this field saying 0, 0 means all, means the entire data set I want to extract, no matter how many rows are there, and perform click on finish. It says, ask me the last question, whether the data is spanning multiple pages. Well, in this case, it is a single page, so I'll keep it as no. And job done. I'm back in my automation studio. My wizard has captured all the details which it needs to extract the table. And what essentially I have got is a variable data, a variable of data type data table. So this is the programming aspect, not a big deal. So what essentially has happened, if I just click on the variables tab, there is one variable created, which is going to store the data in memory. This data I need to save into an Excel file. That's my last step. So I'll simply will search for workbook, and workbook is about Excel automation. There's another set of Excel automation, and there was one question asked earlier. There are two right range activities. So this one is multiple processes can work at the same time on the same Excel file, very much. Right now, I'll be using the workbook and drag and drop this activity. Done. See, it is all drag and drop. So I have the extract structured data, which is performed by the help of data scraping wizard. It has extracted the data and stored into a in-memory variable. And name of the variable is extract data table. Okay, it's asked me, what do you want to do? I say, yes, I want to store it into NSC top gainers dot XLSX. Sheet one is fine, yes. Do you want to store from the A1? Yes. Which data table? I say extract data table. And if you want to store the headers of the data, then you can very well do enable the add headers from the properties. Done. That's it. If you wish to close the browser after it, again, not a problem. Simply search for close in your activities panel where all the actions will be there. And you can drag and drop the close window at the end. As you can see, all drag and drop actions, isn't it? Hardly any coding I've done so far. I don't have to indicate which window to close because I'm inside a scope, a container, which we can talk and learn later. So if you're inside a scope, then I don't have to specifically specify it. All right, my basic automation is ready. Hardly took me 6-7 minutes. Let me close out everything and I'm ready to execute it. Let me explain quickly. What I did, I first of all opened the browser and gave the URL, performed a click action on the view all for the top gainers. Then with the help of data scraping wizard, I extracted the details from the table, all the data from the table, which is stored into a data table variable. And that data table variable I'm using to store the data into an Excel file with the headers enabled. Name of the file is given like this. Of course, you can provide a full path if you wish to. And then finally, closing the browser. So simple it is, right? Of course, it can get very, very complex. We do have advanced level frameworks such as Robotic Enterprise Framework. But at the core of it, it is basically like this, what you just saw. Let me run the automation and see the automation in action. Here we go. You can see the robot has started. Robot has gone to the web page and extracting the data. You can see in my output panel, it has taken only 5 seconds to perform this entire set of actions. Let me check whether we got the file. I'll go to my project folder and wonderful. I got my nsctopgainers.xlx file. Let me open it and see whether the data is extracted as expected. Yes, I got the data. And you can see the data is very much in my Excel sheet. Job well done. Very basic automation, but I just wanted to give you a flavor, especially for people who are very new to RPA. Yes, it would require some more programming concepts in terms of loops and all that, but everything is in the form of activities. Going back to my presentation slides, only one more slide to go. And that is about the training program. And surely I will be answering all the questions that I have not answered so far. So from DevLab Alliance, we are launching a training program starting from this weekend. So it's a 40 hours program, weekends only, starting from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. The 5 days are yellow highlighted in the calendar. So 21st of March. Today is 18th, so we are starting from 21st, 21st, 22nd, 28th, 29th, and 4th of March, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., weekends only, and it will be an online program, likely. Right? So, more details, surely, the Develop Alliance team will be sharing with you. All right. So with that, that's pretty much it I wanted to talk about, and surely I will address your questions. I'll go from the bottom. I think many of the questions I've already answered. What is required to successful automation? So from successful automation, I think the very first thing you should be looking at is that what is your process? RPA is primarily for stable and mature processes. Stable and mature processes. As long as your process is in good shape in your company, you can certainly can consider a very high degree of success in your automation. But if your process is not stable, there are gaps in it, and there are ad hoc actions, then it may not be that successful. Then you might have to look into the parts of the processes that you should be automating rather than the entire process. So we always say that, okay, fix the process first before you apply the automation using RPA. Second part, if your process is having a lot of unstructured data, then of course you will have to apply some additional technology or techniques. Still, you can be very successful, but more the structured data is there in your process, better will be the chance for the success. If you have a lot of unstructured content like freestyle text, image-based text, you have to interpret the content like email body and all that, can be done. AI technologies we have like natural language processing, NLP, machine learning, deep learning, and we can apply that. For example, UiPath has a deep learning based computer vision package. The great thing about RPA is that you have access to all these technologies from activities perspective. So you don't have to be a diehard AI guy or, you know, all you have to do is just drag and drop of activities and use these activities. If I can quickly show, let me see if I can show that quickly. Somebody asked me, can I show? So this is basically using speech. Of course, it's not machine learning or anything like that. But it is using the speech recognition technology. And what I'm doing here is I'm using Google services. So my robot will communicate with, let me open it. My robot will send my details to Google AI services and will understand my speech. And I already integrated this automation with Google's service. So you can see my automation. And this is my robot, okay? This robot is simply doing what? It is basically giving me the weather details for a city. Okay, great. And what it is doing is basically using the speech AI components of Google's cloud platform. These activities, all the details I've already integrated with Google services. So all the details will go on the cloud and will come back with the result. And this process, which you see on your screen, is performing that action. Let me start this to demonstrate this automation to you. Here we go. Now it will be showing me
which city weather you want.
I hope you can hear that, right? So there was a message. There was a sound coming. Which city weather you want? So here we go. I'm responding now. Okay. So I just introduced this button so that it is not listening to all the commands that I'm giving. So here we go. I'm saying Chicago. Let's see what happens. Here we go. Can you see that? I'm talking with my robot and this Chicago text has gone to the Google and now
weather in Chicago is 4 degrees centigrade.
Excellent.
Do you want to get weather for another city?
I hope you're able to listen what my computer is saying. I would say yes.
Which city weather you want?
Excellent. So it is asking me, so it has given me, so my robot is communicating with me, but what is happening behind the scene, it is sending my speech to Google Cloud Platform. The Google Cloud Platform is interpreting, is converting that speech to text. And now, of course, behind the scene, a lot of AI technology is in action. I need not be an AI expert. The Google has done it. Be it computer vision, be it speech related, be it other technologies, surely I can very well build that. So if I simply say, New Delhi.
Sorry, I couldn't get the city name properly.
So see,
please try again.
The robot couldn't get it because my pronunciation is not that great as far as all my accent. So let me try it again. New Delhi. Wonderful. This time it has understood it well, and now it is performing those actions. My robot is working in, it's using AI, it's using speech recognition.
Weather in New Delhi is 25 degrees centigrade.
And job done, right?
Do you want to get weather for another city?
No.
Bye for now.
So you just saw that you can very well leverage technologies available to you from AI world and can perform and integrate with your RPA and perform a more intelligent automation. All right, great. So any other question that prerequisites I already have talked about. So if you are coming from a non-technical background, perfectly fine. RPA can is a technology even for people who are from operations, from business users. You can very well learn it. If you have programming background, nothing like it. It will be even easier for you. But as such, there is no prerequisite, hard prerequisite. But if you are coming with programming background, at least if you know the basics of our programming, you are good to go. Okay, there's one new question. Can this be used in the supply chain? Yes, 100%. In production processes, absolutely. Be it supply chain, be it banking, financial services, insurance, retail, healthcare, aviation, doesn't matter. As I mentioned, RPA is a horizontal technology. Can be applied in any business domain, be it supply chain or any other field, or can be applied to any software. Be it SAP, be it CRM software like Zoho, or be it a software like ServiceNow, Salesforce, Workday, SuccessFactor, you name it, any software, including mainframes, including remote applications, 100% yes. Question is, shall we go for UiPath or automation anywhere? Good question. My take is this. You have to evaluate your product from certain aspects. Of course, which product is the most accepted, most adopted product in the industry, which is UiPath right now. Automation Anywhere stands at number 2 right now. But what I will be looking at from UiPath, or for that matter, any product that I'm selecting, is basically the capability of the product to extend. What are the capabilities in terms of the features and functionalities in it? What is the future roadmap? Can I extend it? Does it provide flexibility in building automation? Does it provide flexibility in terms of integrating with my existing applications, integrating with the artificial intelligence technologies? Does it have a good ecosystem in terms of trainings, in terms of support, in terms of sales and post-sales services? I will be looking at all these aspects before I select a product. UiPath in all these areas stand out very, very strongly. Automation Anywhere is also a good product, but it's basically a distant second, and Blue Prism is surely at number 3. So UiPath certainly scores very high in virtually all the check boxes in my selection list. Sandeep says, are these tools licensed tools? Yes, they are. They are licensed tools. But big news, happy news, good news. UiPath has provided community edition free of cost. Not only software, in fact, it provides a few additional licenses at no cost. Big thanks to UiPath. So people who are willing to learn UiPath can get this software. Plus, another big thing, their certifications are also free right now. All the certification, there are 3 levels of certification, level 1, level 2, level 3. They are free at the moment, right? So you can very well go for the software as a community edition, free licensed software. Same is true with Automation Anywhere as well. But I would say UiPath has done a remarkable job by providing a full-featured, full-functionality software at no cost. Other products have limitations as far as the community edition is concerned. So when you're learning UiPath, you have access to the software, you have access to the licenses, you have access to the content, discussion forums. So many things are available to us without any cost involved. Next question, except touching on software side, RPA can also be integrated with the hardware part or on specific. So when you say hardware part, if you can explain, that will be helpful. But let me try in the meantime. Answer is yes. For example, you might have hardware parts such as maybe printer and more importantly, say your sensors in IoT world, can I integrate with them? Yes, yes, and yes, very much. And people have done it. People have done it. So I can very well have my hardware components as simple as my network devices, my Internet of Things sensors, as simple as printer. Yeah, piece of cake, can be done. So no big challenge. What job prospects are there for professionals who have we are good in business domain but very little knowledge on technical side? Yes, good question. As I mentioned, RPA technology is called, is basically a technology where very, very limited programming concept will be there, or you need very little knowledge upon the programming side, as simple as the basic of data types, variables, and all that. Now, the great thing about business domain users, operations people, business users, they are expert. They are good in the business process side. They understand the processes. They understand all the execution paths. Now, the process modeling, building the process execution map will not be a difficult challenge for them. Now, what about the flow of data? As I mentioned that if as long as you have aptitude to understand the basics like data types, variables, like in our earlier example, we use this data table variable to store, extract the data from web page and save it into the Excel file, right? Pretty simple, straightforward thing. So even people who are basically coming from the operation side, from business user side, they can very well build the skills in RPA and can find themselves in a very good position either to continue with their current existing job role and apply the automation technology themselves, or look for a job which is purely into the automation world. So great prospects for people who are into operation side, who are into business user side, who are into QA side, who are in, even people who are into software development, it's a great technology to be in. All right. So any other question before we conclude our session? I know I've overstepped by 22 minutes so far. What are the limitations of RPA? Okay. So I won't call it, there could be limitations at the moment, but I mean, that is limitation even from human worker side as well. So the RPA limitations are not many, to be honest. The limitations is only that we are still into the development mode. It's a new technology, relatively speaking. Only, I would say, mainstream adoption has been 3 years only. So a lot of development is happening right now into the products. So UiPath, Automation Anywhere, Blue Prism, and many others are still in developing new features and capabilities. One of the area would be artificial intelligence components, which these companies are building, right? So I won't call it a limitation per se. As long as your process is mature, is stable, you can very well build the automation. The limitation in one sense would be that if you build automation on a bad process, then your output probably will be bad. It's very simple, garbage in, garbage out kind of situation. Other than that, you can very well build the automation using RPA. Now, as a human worker, we have a great strength under the umbrella of common sense. Common sense. Well, that level of intelligence you can't expect from RPA today. What will happen 10 years down the line? Time will tell. It is increasing every year. It is improving every year. So other than that, because human workers are smart, they can apply common sense and can. RPA will work exactly as instructed in your automation script. So from that perspective, I don't know whether you call it as a limitation or not, but yes, robots can't apply the common sense at least today. But with the more and more involvement of AI technology, cognitive abilities, it will be able to even come closer to what the way we function. All right, so any other question, please let us know. All right, thank you everyone. Good to see that many questions are coming through, and I hope I've answered your questions. If you're interested in more detailed training program, please do contact DevLabs Alliance team, and we'll be more than happy to have you in our training programs, which is starting from 21st. With that, once again, thank you so much. Bye for now.